okay?
Go ahead.
Here we go. Guys, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Could you pray with me? It's good to be here with our brothers and sisters. Thank you, Lord, for the health that you have brought us and for the health that you're going to bring to the rest that maybe are still not quite over it. But I just praise you, Lord, for your goodness. As we meet together today, Lord, we want to honor you. We want to praise the name of Jesus. We want to love each other. And God, we just want to have a good time in you. So Lord, bless this time as we sing. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 We got to let the baby go. So yesterday, her birthday. Today, Aaron.
Whose birthday?
Whose birthday is it today? Yes. So let's sing happy birthday, guys.
Happy birthday to y'all.
Okay, so Little Drummer Boy, this is one of my favorite songs about the birth of Jesus. Now, the reason I love it so much, it might be silly to some. What are you doing? The reason I love it so much is because it speaks of a God who loves us. And he doesn't love us because of what we can bring to him. He doesn't love us because we can bring him a whole lot of riches and things. He loves us because he loves us. And whatever is in our heart to offer to the Lord, if it's offered with love and honor to God, he receives it. And that's why I love this Little Drummer Boy. Y'all can sing with me. This request was from Brother Pat.
Brother Pat.
Brother Pat.
Down one.
Down one.
Down half a
yourself. Amen. Anybody has anything you want to say, share, testify? This service belongs to Jesus. Go.
While we were gone, it was amazing to just testify. Even people who don't walk with the Lord were testifying of the things that the Lord had done to make sure that we were all together this week.
Yeah.
It was pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing. So
I have noticed that people don't even claim to believe in God or that there is a God. I've been around them to where they'll mention, well, it must have been God's will. And I'm like, where'd that come from?
Yeah.
Or he orchestrated this, or he brought this about. So we've got some on the road. The climbers are, no, they're not on the road. Who's on the road? Bernie, the Morrises are on the road. And so we want to remember them that they will be safe as well. Anybody else have something you'd like to say? Or, well, it's good to see you guys here. Yeah, go, Sarah. Amen. He is always faithful. Praise God. It's really good. You know, we celebrate, of course, we are leaving, really. We're going to go, and our family's going to celebrate their birthdays because we, you know, we try to get together and take off for their birthdays. But if any of y'all know much about Megan's story, some of you probably do. We did talk about it on Daybreak yesterday. Was that yesterday? Yes, yesterday. And, you know, she was a preemie, so she really came early. It was a miracle that Miss Megan lived. Miracle. Then when she was 6 years old, at a baptizing, she walked out in front of a car and was run over by a car. And God brought her back. It was a miracle. It's one of those times to where I really don't care what anybody out in the world wants to think. It doesn't matter what kind of theologian you think you are. If you think God does not still do miracles, you are wrong. God still does miracles. Now, he don't do them when I snap my fingers, but he does miracles. And ever so often, he sees fit to hear our prayers and to answer them and do great and mighty miracles. And I just thank God for that. And we remember we missed the Axes today, you know, Larry and Melody. And I need to go see them very soon. I miss them very much. Just have not been able to get the opportunity to get over there lately. But I need to go see them.
Well, you didn't want to take them what we had.
No, not when we were sick, you know, and we went through some bad sickness as a family as well. So we're going to dive in. Today I'm going to be talking about the behavior, disciple behavior. Disciple behavior, or behavior of a Christian. You can claim it any way you want to. But what should it look like if we are following the Messiah, Jesus? What should we look like? What should our lives look like if we're truly born again? I'm not saying that we say we're born again. I'm not saying that we say that we're believers. I mean, really, what should it look like if we're believers? And this portion of Scripture we are going to read, if you've got your Bibles, I want you to be opening to Romans chapter 12. We're going to start with verse 9 and finish out the chapter. And as we go over this, I feel every true born-again believer in here is going to say, whoa, I got some work to do. And I will amen you, we all have work to do on this. But because we have work to do, because we have areas we need to work on, does not mean that we need to neglect studying who we are supposed to be and aspiring to be these people that God has called us to be. Can I get an amen to that?
Amen.
There is a way that we are supposed to look. And as you're opening up to Romans chapter 12, guys, We are to be seen as pilgrims and strangers in a foreign land. If you could accept it in some kind of a way, we're like aliens on this place. Jesus says, you're in this world, but you're not to be of this world. That is to say, we live on this land, we live in society, we live in communities, but we are supposed to look different, act different, respond different than everybody else around us. And that difference is supposed to be, and I'm not saying it is supposed to be so definite and so marked that the people of the world find us strange. Did you know that? The Bible even says that we're supposed to be strange and thought of as strange. So when we get into Romans chapter 12, and wherever you're at, open to Romans chapter 12, look at verse 9, and we're going to begin talking about behaviors. And we could say this, behave like a disciple. Behave like a Christian. What does that behavior look like? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to start with the first two verses here of the sermon, which is 9 and 10. Here's what it says. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love, in honor preferring, or in honor giving preference to one another. I'm reading out of the New King James Version. If you were to read this in the ESV, it would say,
let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor.
Outdo one another in showing honor. So, let's take a line at a time. And we're going to finish this chapter. Line at a time. At least when you leave here, you say, well, that's what I'm supposed to look like then. First, he says, let love be without hypocrisy. Let love not be something that you have to act. Let it be genuine. Let it be real in your life. What does real love look like? Well, for that, I want you to flip over to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Now, I read this. Every time I marry somebody, I read this. Every time I marry somebody, I quote this. But this is actually, even though it fits with marriage because it fits with true love, it is supposed to be in our daily life as a Christian. Starting with verse 4, here's what real love. So you say, okay, don't act like you're loving. Really love people. Well, what does love look like? Because, guys, love is a verb. Right. It's a verb. Verse 4, love suffers long and is kind. Love suffers long and is kind. God, let this sink into me. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love doesn't get jealous of everybody. Jealousy has no part in true Christian love. Why? We didn't read the text. He says, look, outdo one another in showing honor. We're supposed to desire to honor each other so much that we want to see our brothers and sisters' good thing happen to them. It's not supposed to make us jealous. It's supposed to be a blessing. Yes, Lord, yes, bless them. Yes, Lord, bless them. That's how we should feel. Love doesn't envy. Love does not parade itself. Is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Look at this. Does not seek its own. This is what we're talking about today. And if you know anything about the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ, the apostle is bringing out exactly the character and model of Jesus Christ. Here's a model that you need to keep in your mind. Regardless of anything else, when you live upon this earth, you need to see Jesus on the cross. See Jesus being executed. See Him hanging there, bleeding, saying to the Father, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. If we can get a glimpse of that kind of love, pettiness will leave our life. What do you mean they don't know what they're doing? They know they crucified Jesus. But Jesus is saying, they don't know. They don't know, Father. They don't understand. Forgive them, Father. So many times, instead of being the humble one, we want to be right. We live our lives like, no, me, I'm right. When the apostle says, suffer yourself to be defrauded. Suffer yourself to be wronged. Matter of fact, did you know when it comes to rewards between you and God in the kingdom, the rewards you're going to get, do you know that you get a better reward if you suffer wrongly but you're peaceful about it and you love people? You get a reward for that. And did you know that Jesus said, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven? That's where you want to lay up treasures. That's where you want your mansion to be. That's where you want to build a heritage. So look at this. Love does not seek its own. It's not provoked. It thinks no evil. Oh my goodness. How quick do we think evil? It's like our default. We think evil about everything. There's a lot of politicians that I'm pretty upset with in the sense of righteousness and holiness. But God has been stirring my heart. He says, pray for them. Pray for them. But they're destroying America. Pray for them. Sincerely pray for them. And that's hard for us to do. You see, there's a lot of things about Christianity that we as Christians don't like. And if I'm to be totally honest, and I'm not saying you, but I'm saying as a whole, Christians are big babies. It's like they run around, like when my kids were little and with temper tantrums, 2 year old. I'm not getting what I want. I'm not getting what I want. And that's how Christians act.
Yes. And we don't
want to
grow up.
Don't want to grow up. No. I want to stay on the bottle. I don't want to feed myself. Thinks no evil. Lord, train our minds because we love, because we see this world like you do. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He so loved the world that he gave. Let us think like you, Lord. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears, true love bears all things. It believes all things. It hopes all things. And what's that next three words? Endures all things. True love never fails. Other things are going to fail. Real love won't fail. You say, well, how can I help people? Love them. Love them. And we're going to see as we go through the text and back in Romans, we're not just talking about our brothers. But where there's, love never fails. Okay, turn back. Romans chapter 12, let's go back now. That's what love, he says, let love be without hypocrisy. Don't be an actor. Let it be sincere. Let it be real. Abhor what is evil. It means hate what is evil. If you are filled with the Holy Spirit, God's Holy Spirit dwells in you. So your nature, your consciousness, your the center of the being of who you are, has the Holy Spirit at the center of it. And so your moral code should not like what is evil. You should abhor what is evil. Because you know it's bringing destruction. You know that it's hurting people. Abhor what is evil and cling or cleave to what is good. Hold on to what is good. Now look at verse 10. Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love in honor, giving preference to one another. ESV says, outdo one another in showing honor. Okay, so we like to be competitive. How many of you are competitive when you're playing a game? And I bet the rest of you, it didn't raise your hand, I bet you are too. I mean, we want to win. Not you. Josh says Josh, when Josh is playing a game, he wants to lose. But it's a joke. Seriously, this is a competition that the apostle says you need to get into. What is the competition? Outdo one another in showing honor. Let's see who could honor each other the best. Who can show more honor to each other? No, you don't get envy. Listen, if somebody is being honored and it is a brother or a sister in the Lord, it should bring you joy that they're being honored, not make you jealous.
Amen.
Okay? And so why, Brother Scott, are you preaching this? Because we need to get the Word of God in us, because sometimes we realize that we get a little envious, we get a little jealous, and we need to stop that. No, that's not the way we need to feel. And something's wrong in my heart. I'm not where I need to be with the Lord if I'm not honoring my brother, because I want good to happen to you. You should want good to happen to me. I want you to prosper. I want you to be in health. I want good things to happen at your job. I want good things to happen with your car. And I want good things to happen with your home. We should want that for each other. And then honor each other. Honor each other. Honor each other. And if you're going to honor somebody else, you got to humble yourself. It's not always easy to do. Okay, verse 11, let's move on, or I'm never going to get through these. Not lagging in diligence. The funny thing, that's New King James Version. King James Version says, not slothful in business. You ever seen a sloth? Anybody ever seen a sloth? You seen a sloth? I was at the zoo one time. I was just blown away by the sloth. He's like this. Don't say I look like a sloth, babe. I mean, they're like barely moving. So I like the King James Version rendering there. Don't be slothful in your business. Come on, Christians, get to work. He says, don't be barely moving out there, never getting it done. Get to work. Hallelujah. Not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit. Serving the Lord. How do I serve the Lord? Serving my brother. How do I honor the Lord? Honoring my brother. Outdoing each other and showing honor. This is what he wants. Continuing steadfastly in prayer. And then verse 13. I get to brag on you guys here quite a bit. Distributing to the needs of the saints, given to hospitality. Woo! I'm telling you, if there's one place where true, born-again, believing disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ should look different than anybody else in the world, is right here. Distributing to the needs of the saints.
Yep.
Why? Because we're not exalting ourselves. We're showing honor to others. This is one thing I can brag. I brag on this church here. I brag on Church Without Walls. There's a lot of things I brag on you guys to other people about, but this is probably the top of the list, is your diligence and your love and your desire to help orphans, your desire to help the hurting saints around the world, your desire to give to those things, and you want to give to those things, right? I mean, that comfort is minimized and distribution to the needs of the saints is maximized. It's a blessing.
Amen.
I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it that we bought Nadim a car. I love it.
Did he get a car?
He's getting a car.
But he doesn't have it yet.
They're picking out day. They're supposed to. I had to send it in sections because they can only receive so much at a time. So they had to get the money together. They're going to get it now. But I'm so blessed by that. His family is just, yesterday, I was on a video call with him and his kids are jumping up and down because they ain't got to walk all the time anymore. They are so happy.
And they ain't got to hang on that moment.
They're like, Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas. Thank you for the Christmas present, you know. And it's like, it's not me, it's us. We did this. God did that through you, and that's a blessing. That's such an honor. When that's preferring others over yourself, is it not? Okay. Given to hospitality, which means you're willing to take somebody in if they need, if you need to. Our homes can be a refuge if somebody needs it, right?
Amen.
Verse 14. What about this one, guys? Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Everybody amen that.
Amen.
Bless those who curse you. Persecute you. Bless and don't curse them. Now that's powerful. What do you want to do when somebody hurts you? What do you want to do when somebody says something that's not true about you? What do you want to do when somebody wants to bring up your failures of your past when you have repented of that and you went on? You want to say something back. You know, get them back. It's nature. Look, it is part of who we are. It's like, how dare you? I'll get you. And we think of a way, well, here's what I can say about them. We see it most in politics, do we not? But it's not just in politics. It's in churches too. It happens all the time.
Yeah, but instead of calling it mudslinging, we call it prayer request.
Yeah. Bless and do not curse. Have you ever thought about, okay, they're persecuting me. God, they're persecuting me. Lord, they are persecuting me because I am a believer. Lord, bless them. Lord, bless them. I'm not praying for you to send curses. I'm not praying for you to call down, to send down fire and devour them. I'm asking that they'll be saved. Lord, I want you to bless them. I want you to reveal yourself to them. I want you to be with them and help them and open their eyes. Open their eyes that they may know. You probably have to deal with this at work, Pat. Sometimes, I don't know. I certainly have had to deal with that at work. And it's one thing to read it. It's another thing to amen it. It's another thing to say, yeah, that's right. It's a totally another thing to do it. Because here's the reality. Sometimes you get persecuted, you just want to knock them out. I'm just being real. You do. You're like, all right, let's go outside, pal. But it ain't the way I need to be. It ain't the way you need to be. I'm not that way now, by the way. I'm not trying to knock anybody out. But I have been. But I have been. And it is something that you have to battle. And you say, you mean I need to battle it? Yes, you need to battle it. I need to suppress it? Yes. By the power of the Holy Ghost, you suppress that. You don't respond in the same way that they do. And that's what makes you peculiar and different than everybody else. I personally think Josh is very good at this. In his character. I can brag on you, and you can receive it. Because I'm bragging on you. I'm honoring him. But he's got that personality. He's got that I'll walk away personality. And I love that about him. That's a beautiful thing. Let's go forward. Verse 15. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Man, when something good happens for one of our brothers and sisters in the Lord, it should make us happy. We can rejoice with them. You're dancing? I'm going to dance. Hallelujah. Weep with those who weep. This week, we had that opportunity. Sister Rachel lost her brother, and she's weeping over losing her brother, and we wept with her. Why? Because she's our sister, and she's hurting. And that's how the body is supposed to act. When it's hurting you, it's hurting me. And I remember one time Brother Ray Vanderlaan said, and this stuck with me. I've never took it to the Christian church as a whole around the world. And he was talking about how there's only one body. There's one body. And if the toe and the foot is hurting, the whole body is hurting. And I remember Ray Vanderlaan, he said, the very fact that Christians in other parts of the world can be suffering persecution, can be thrown into jail, can be beat and whipped, and the American church can't feel a thing, something's wrong with us. It should grab my heart. When my brothers and sisters in Iran are being beat because they didn't have something over their head. When the sister gets killed because she took her head thing off. It should break our heart. We should weep. should break our heart. And it did me. I don't know about you, if you know anything about the church in Afghanistan. When all that debacle of the pullout took place, and a whole lot of the Christians escaped because they knew what was coming, but there was other pastors, there was other families, there was other Christians. They said, we're going to stay. And we know we may die, but we're going to stay because if we leave, the witness of Christ leaves Afghanistan. And I honor that. I'm like, God, I want to be more like that. I don't want to be like this American Christianity. I want to be like that. Help me to be more like that. And when they hurt, we hurt. That's how we should feel because we're one body. And when they rejoice, we rejoice. Thank you, Jesus. Let's move on. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. You ever practically think about this? I'm telling you, this is the teachings of the apostles, and it's the teachings of the Lord. You know, Jesus would go around, and sometimes people would be with people. Jesus would be with people that all the people just didn't get. They didn't understand. They'd be like, what the heck's he doing hanging out with them? If he really knew who she was, he would not let her touch him. You've read that, right? What Jesus did, he said, he heard his thoughts. He said, I know who this woman is, Simon. And let me tell you something. I come into your house, you didn't even give me anything to wash my feet. But yet she is washing my feet with her tears. She's drying them with her hair. And I'm going to tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. And one who is forgiven much, they love much. And basically he's saying, Simon, you don't love at all because you don't think you need forgiveness. Why would he eat with sinners and tax collectors? Why would he do that? Who is this dude? That's our king. That's who we're following. Be not high-minded. Associate with the humble. When you get in the crowd and you see somebody left out over there, somebody nobody wants to fool with, taught this. I've drilled this into my kids. Go talk to them. Let them feel loved. Don't make them feel like they don't belong to the human race because they don't have as much as you have. We're all born in different situations. We are born in different families. We all grow up, and all of us grow up getting scarred in our life. And those scars affect us in different ways, and we have to deal with them as adults. And we got to take them to the Lord. And you know, some people are hurt more than others. And if I could ever train you to do anything, it's try to see everybody through the lens of, well, maybe they've really been hurt. Thinketh no evil. Try to think good. Try to make it. You see, love tries to make excuses for people if you can. It's beautiful. Well, maybe they didn't know what they were doing, Father. Forgive them. Let's move on. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Hello. Who's the smartest? And everybody in here go, I'm the smartest. I'm the one that's got it figured out. If you just knew what I knew, we don't say that, but we kind of act that way sometimes. The older I get, the more I realize how stupid I am. I'm serious. When I was a young man, I knew everything, especially 18 to like 27. You couldn't tell me nothing. I know. I don't care if you've been here 30 years more than me. I still know more than you know. Because I understand things that you just don't understand. Then you go through your 30s. Then you go through your 40s. Then you hit 50 and you go, man, what an ignorant kid I was. And it keeps happening. And you know what I do now? I love to talk to older people. I like to talk to Brother Charles, Sister Cheryl, and Brother Larry. And I'm like, okay. Because just by virtue of living a long time on earth, you've got a little more wisdom. Can I get an amen to that? I love it. Don't be wise in your own opinion. Number 17, listen to this one. Repay no one evil for evil. Let me read it again. Repay no one evil for evil. Let me read it one more time. Repay no one evil for evil. And while you're doing that, you know, statistics says it takes 7 times to sink in. Don't repay people evil for evil. And that's a hard thing for us to grasp. But it's not because they don't deserve payment. And it's not that they don't deserve judgment. We're going to learn that in a minute. There's something you've got to understand to be able to hold to this as a Christian. Let's read on. Don't repay anyone evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. Now listen to verse 18. If it be possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. Why? For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Now here's something you've got to get a hold of this, or you can never do this. You can never obey these scriptures if you don't get this in your heart. You are not throwing away your right to repay somebody evil for evil that they should get. And this is not for a judge. This is not for a police officer. Okay, we're talking about for Christians. We're talking about in regular life. Do not repay evil for evil. But here's the purpose. It's not because they don't deserve it, but it's because God is long-suffering and He's merciful and He says vengeance belongs to Him. He is going to repay. Vengeance is Him. Vengeance is coming. Nobody's getting by with anything. And if you can get a hold of that, then you could actually even have some compassion. I have compassion for people sometimes. I'm like, oh my goodness. You know what it's going to be like for them if they don't repent and turn around? Do you know what George Soros is going to experience if God doesn't get his heart? Do you realize what these world leaders who have no regard for God or righteousness or holiness, do you realize what they're going to suffer in eternity for the decisions they've made and who they've hurt? God is going to repay them. However, timing is everything. And God is long-suffering. And there was a time, and there have been more than one time in my life, that I deserved God to just squash me like a bug. And you did too, probably. But He was merciful on you, and you came to repentance, and now you don't have to have that. When you get a hold of how much you've been forgiven, or at least for me, because I'm the one that's been forgiven much. And when that comes into my heart, I was driving this morning, I'm looking at the sky, and I just feel God's love washing over me. I begin to just weep in my truck as I'm thinking about how good God is and how good He's been to me and my family and my children and my grandbabies. He's good to me. And not because I deserved it. He's had mercy on me. He had mercy. And I wouldn't have put up with me. If I was God, I'd have killed me a long time ago. And you wouldn't have put up with you either. I think, unless you are wise in your own opinion. Do not avenge yourselves. Give place to wrath, God. Vengeance is yours. Vengeance is yours, God. So, Lord, how do I need then those my enemies, those that are against me, what do I need to do? How do I need to respond physically on this earth? How do I need to respond to them as I live here? Thus says the Lord, verse 20. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, what do you do? This is not, brother, I'm not saying this. God is saying. If you believe this is God's word, this is His word. This isn't my word. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. Try to put that in perspective. I mean, my goodness. How many of you know about William Wormbrand? Voice of Martyrs. My goodness. They made a movie. Y'all seen the movie about his life? This is beyond comprehension. This has to be the Holy Spirit to where he had such a love for the man who was tormenting him and beating him every day. You know, they pull him into that room, hang him upside down, they take and beat his feet till he was just crippled. And God gave him such a love for that man. That's supernatural. You can't do that. That is supernatural. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. Why? For in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Vengeance is the Lord. God is going to repay. And you've got something to do with him as he stands before the Lord, as you are kind to those who are not kind to you. And you feed those who is you consider your enemy. And I've heard this actually played out between two neighbors. I heard this story about a neighbor that was just rotten. He was so mean. And every time he would come and do something terrible, he'd cut the fence, he would do something terrible to the neighbor. The wife would bake him something and take it to his house and give it to him. This kept happening. And I don't remember how long it took, but finally the neighbor broke down. How? I'm awful to you. I'm terrible to you. Why would you bake me something? Why would you bring me something? And they're able to share the gospel. And the man comes to the Lord.
And becomes a very good neighbor.
And becomes a very good neighbor. And that doesn't mean that's always going to happen. But yet, look. Verse 21, and I'm ending here. Do not be overcome by evil. God help us today. Get this. Don't be overcome by evil. Don't let the news get to you. Don't let the evil out there get to you and change who you are as a Christian and change your attitude towards everybody. Because if all we see is the evil, the next thing you know, you're just mad at everybody. You're just angry at everything that's going on. And we got to not have that heart. Don't be overcome by the evil, but rather overcome evil by good. Love people. Love people, love people. Maybe we're going to try to put this into practice in the future in practical ways. We see something we don't like happening in Carthage, we're going to go bless those people. Do something good for them. Love on them. At first, they're going to think that we're just right in line with everything they like. And then they're going to find out, no, we're not. But we love you. We love you. And if you don't come to the Lord, the vengeance that's going to be in your life is terrible. Guys, I really believe every knee is going to bow, every tongue is going to confess to the Lord. And right now, you've got to see people as blind. They're blind. And they can't see. And God wants to use you. He wants to use Church Without Walls to take blinders off. He wants that love to penetrate because love is the only thing that never fails. It will not fail. And it's going to heap coals of fire. And if they never repent, it's just going to add to the vengeance that they're going to get at the end. But we're not doing it to add to the vengeance. Amen? We're doing it because we love our enemies, because God loved us when we're his enemies. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. But come to repentance and have life. That is why God sent Jesus. To save us. And because he loves us. In Jesus' name. Yeah.
I was thinking about the scripture that talks about the watchman on the wall. You know, we see these people headed for danger, but they're not going to listen to us if we're just yelling at them about how bad they are. But if we can come alongside and love them and then warn them, you know, because the word says, see the trouble and we don't cry out, their blood's upon our hand. If we cry out and they don't listen, their blood's upon their own head.
Yeah.
But we have to cry out.
I can't honestly say that nobody's blood's ever been on my hand. I look at my life as a Christian, I couldn't say that. But I don't want anybody's blood on my hand.
Amen.
You know, I want to love people. You guys are really good at loving. Most of everything I've said today, I'm very, very proud of you. I'm proud of who you are. I'm proud of who you are becoming as disciples of the Lord. That it's not just, oh, I'm a Christian. It's not just some flippant thing. That you're putting skin in the game. You give till it hurts, and I thank God for that. You know, we send money all over this world. You realize we're in so many countries, it's amazing. Helping Christians in Iran, helping Christians in Afghanistan, helping the underground church in many places, not just Pakistan, not just Haiti. We're helping people everywhere. And I thank God for you. Keep it up. Stay in the Word. Be who you're supposed to be. And we'll just keep on pounding against that wall with love. Our big sledgehammer is love. And we're just going to keep hammering. Anybody else before I say a closing prayer? Then let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Did you have something? No. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your goodness. Thank you for Paul and the words you gave him to help us. Lord, I'm asking you to help us to be like you. Help us to be more like Jesus. Lord, you are here in the flesh for three and a half years, and you absolutely turned the world upside down. The dates are changed because you came. And Father, what a life you lived to make such a difference and such an impact on this world. And God, I pray this for not only Church Without Walls, but I pray this for every born-again Christian, that you would keep teaching us what it means to be your disciple and to live the way you have called us to live. And God, we're really asking you to help us with this loving our enemy thing. It's just really hard for us, and I know you know that. But Father, help us, God, to get our mind right and not to be overcome by the evil that is in the world, by our emotions, and help us, Father, to pray more and more and help people more and more. Father, we pray for more and more people to be saved in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you for whatever food we have today. Is our food back there? Okay. And everybody's dismissed. Amen. Thanks for coming.